This is 2.1 types of chemical bonds. Our outcome is I can explain the relationship between the type of bonding and the properties of the elements participating in the bond. So first we're going to talk about average valence electron energy. So this chart right here is given the ionization energies by subshell. So it gives us the outer shell S and P electrons for several elements here. This is our ionization energies. So to calculate AVEE, which is a measure of how tightly an atom holds onto its valence electrons, we need to multiply the number of electrons in the S shell by the ionization energy of the S shell, and then add that to the product of the number of valence electrons in the P shell times the ionization energy of the P shell. And then we divide that by the total number of valence electrons. So here is the AVEEs for several elements. And the first question is just to confirm the AVEE that we have for boron and carbon. So carbon has two S electrons and two P electrons. So I'm multiplying that by the ionization energies that I got from the chart above. And then I'm going to divide by the total number of valence electrons. So we get these values and they do match. Metalloids are highlighted in blue in the chart, provide a justification for the placement of the metalloid line. So generally, elements with AVEEs less than 1 are going to be metals, and AVEEs greater than 1 are generally going to be nonmetals. So the line includes the elements that have AVEEs around 1. So the metalloid values, we're expecting them to be somewhere between the values of metals and nonmetals, because metalloids have properties between metals and nonmetals. Give the range of AVEE values for metals, nonmetals, and metalloids. So we see that metalloid values are generally in between the metal and nonmetal values. So how is this consistent with the shell model of the atom? So AVEE is a measure of how tightly an atom is holding on to those valence electrons. So nonmetals are going to hold more tightly onto their electrons than metals because they tend to have more positive nuclei. So on the periodic table, the nonmetals are all kind of grouped on the right side. And those are the elements that are going to have the most protons in their nucleus in a given row. So AVEEs are also going to decrease down a column as the valence electrons are further away from the nucleus in a more distant shell or energy level. So number 4 says to compare the AVEE values of atoms that tend to form cations, those are our metals, to those that typically form anions, those are our nonmetals. So cations and metals, those nuclei tend to be less positive. So there's this weaker electron interaction, a weaker attraction, and they have low ionization energy. So it's easy to remove electrons, and that means they tend to form cations. The anions slash nonmetals tend to have more positive nuclei and stronger electron attraction. They're going to have very high ionization energy. So it's going to be hard to remove those electrons. So they're going to tend to form anions. So why do AVEEs increase as we go from left to right across a period, series, or row? What other periodic property has this same trend? So the nucleus becomes more positive as we go across the row because more protons are being added. Electrons are also added, but they're all being added to the same energy level, so they're the same distance from the nucleus. So this means that the electrons are more attracted to their nucleus as you move across a row on the periodic table. Ionization energy follows this same trend. Why do the AVEEs decrease as you go down a group? So that's going to be because those electrons are further away from the nucleus in a more distant energy level or shell. So this is approximately the same trend that we see with atomic radius. It's an inverse trend, but we see that as atomic radius gets bigger, that AVEEs get smaller. So why is BE more likely to form BE plus 2 than S is to form S plus 2? So BE has two energy levels, whereas S has three. So you might predict that S would lose electrons more easily. But in this case, the effect of the difference in those energy levels is smaller than the effect of the more positive nucleus that sulfur has. So this makes it harder to remove electrons from sulfur with its plus 16 charge in the nucleus to form a cation than from BE, which only has a plus 4 charge. So without referencing the AVEE chart, arrange the following in order of increasing AVEE. So this is one of those types of questions where understanding the layout of the periodic table is important. So if you open up a copy of a periodic table, we want to compare the positions of these elements. So I've got magnesium, phosphorus, and chlorine. Those all have the same atomic radius, so the difference in AVEE must be due to the charge of their nucleus. In the next one, we've got SE, F, O, and S. So we've got kind of these elements right here. So between oxygen and fluorine, we're going to have an increasing AVEE on fluorine because its nucleus is more positive. And then looking at oxygen, sulfur, and selenium, we're looking at different numbers of energy levels. The last one, we've got potassium, phosphorus, and oxygen. So here we have different numbers of shells. So potassium will have the lowest because it has the most shells, and oxygen has the fewest shells, so it will have the highest AVEE. So this leads us to this idea of partial charge. So in a chemical bond, one of the atoms typically has more electron attracting power or pull than the other. So as a result, one of those atoms is going to have a partial negative charge and the other will have a partial positive charge. We can determine the partial charge experimentally, but here's a mathematical way that we can estimate this value. So this will involve calculating the pool for hydrogen and the pool for fluorine, and that's based on their AVEEs. In our equation here, the number of valence electrons on atom, we're going to subtract that from the non-bonding electrons on atom. So those are the electrons that do not participate in a bond. They're already paired whenever you draw your Lewis structure. So first, to find the pool of hydrogen, we need to use the AVEE values for hydrogen and fluoride. And then we can plug that into our equation here. And we see that we get plus 0.27 for hydrogen and minus 0.27 for fluoride. So considering the partial charges in HF, what is the basis of the 7, 6, and 2? So the 7 is the number of valence electrons on fluoride, so on fluorine rather. So there's 7 total. 6 is the non-bonding electrons. Those are the ones that are paired together in that Lewis structure. And then 2 is the number of electrons that are in the HF bond. So when two different atoms share electrons, the one that's better at attracting electrons slash has a higher electronegativity is going to be the one that has the partial negative charge. So for HF, why is the partial charge on F equal to, but opposite in sign to the partial charge on H? This is because there's only two atoms involved. So any electron density that is lost by hydrogen is gained by fluorine. So for any diatomic molecule, the sum of those partial charges should add up to zero for a neutral molecule. So here, we're looking at the AVE of bromine, and we want to calculate the partial charge on Br in HBr, and then we want to find the partial charge on Br in Br2. So whenever I solve, I get a partial charge on H and a partial charge, partial negative charge on bromine. So whenever we do it for bromine, though, we get that there's a partial charge of zero. So this makes sense because each bromine atom is pulling on that shared electron with the same strength. So this is why the molecule is nonpolar. It doesn't have these partial negative and partial charges that form due to differing electronegativities. So what is the charge on any atom in a homonuclear diatomic molecule? This means a molecule that's made of two of the same atoms. It's going to be zero, and these molecules will be nonpolar. So let's look at AVEE and partial charge. So here is the partial charges for several molecules, as well as the AVEEs for several atoms. So note the AVEE values for H and Cl. Why is it reasonable that H has a partial positive charge and chlorine has a partial negative charge? So chlorine has a higher AVEE, so it's going to attract electrons more than hydrogen. Taking a look at the partial charges in HF and HCl. So fluorine has a higher AVEE than chlorine, and this is due to the size of the atom. Chlorine has a greater atomic radius. So the centers of positive and negative charge on the molecule are further apart in HCl than in HF. So that means that HF is going to be more polar than HCl. HI kind of switches it. So we see that for these molecules here, that hydrogen always has the partial positive, but here it has a partial negative. So iodine has a very large radius, and the AVEE of iodine is very similar to that of hydrogen. So this effect is going to be very small because they have very similar AVEEs, but the electrons are able to get closer to the hydrogen nucleus because its radius is so much smaller. So this is enough to pull electron density very slightly towards hydrogen, which is why we get this very small partial positive and partial negative charge. This data gives partial charges for several molecules, so it gives the central atom as well as the terminal atoms. So we want to use AVEEs to rationalize the positive and negative aspects of these charges whenever we compare methane and tetrafluoromethane. So we're comparing these two molecules here, and we notice that the carbon in this case has a partial negative charge, and in the tetrafluoromethane, the carbon has a partial positive charge. So this is because fluorine has a higher AVEE than carbon. So those fluorine atoms will have a negative partial charge in CF4. But in the other molecule, carbon has a higher AVEE than H. So those H atoms will have the partial positive charge in CH4 instead of the central carbon. In both cases, we should be able to add up those partial charges, and they should equal zero for any neutral molecule. Compare the values of partial charges on the nitrogen atom in ammonia and in trifluoronitrogen. So now we're looking at these two. And notice that in ammonia, the central nitrogen has a negative charge, and in trifluoronitrogen, the central nitrogen has a positive charge. So this is because the AVEE of nitrogen is greater than hydrogen, but not greater than fluorine. Number 16 is asking us to calculate the sum of the partial charges for each of these molecules. So methane has one carbon and four hydrogens. Water has one oxygen and two hydrogens. So we're putting together these partial charges. Now, for methane and water, we get zero, and that makes sense because those are neutrally charged molecules. But in the ammonium ion and the carbonate ion, the sum of the charges is going to add up to whatever the charge on the ion is. So what is the relationship between the charge on the molecule or ion and the sum of the partial charges? Those partial charges should add up to match the overall charge on the molecule. So now we can get into looking at electronegativity. So the electronegativity scale shows the ability of an atom that's in a molecule to attract electrons. So the scale that was first proposed by Linus Pauling has been refined with more recent experimental evidence. And this gives us values of electronegativity values. So looking at HF and HBr, we see that the HF has a partial positive charge that is much greater than it is in HBr. So why is this? This is because fluorine is more electronegative than bromine, and both are more electronegative than hydrogen. Therefore, the partial charge on F in HF should be more negative than the partial charge on Br in HBr. So we see that in HF, because there's a bigger electronegativity difference, we get a bigger separation of charge, and the partial charge on H in HF will be more positive than it is in HBr. So the trend in ionization energy is the same as the trend in electronegativity. This is reasonable because they're both measures of how tightly an atom holds on to its electrons. So now we can start to talk about polar, nonpolar, and ionic bonds. So a nonpolar covalent bond is formed between identical atoms. A polar covalent bond is generally formed between two atoms that have a small electronegativity difference, whereas an ionic bond is formed when there's a big electronegativity difference. There is no sharing of electrons. So why do homonuclear molecules have nonpolar bonds? Both atoms are identical, they have the same electronegativity, so they pull on the electrons with the same strength. We want to classify these as polar, nonpolar, or ionic. So in general, when you're looking for an ionic compound, you're looking for two elements that have a really big difference in electronegativity. So that's usually going to be a metal and a nonmetal. So NaF, KCl, CuO, those are all ionic compounds. Now, our polar and nonpolar compounds are going to be made from nonmetals. And we see that we have some homonuclear molecules where they will have the same electronegativity, so they will be nonpolar. So that's like oxygen and iodine. And then the polar molecules are going to be the ones that are nonmetals that have different electronegativities. So CO, NO, CN minus, and ICl. So provide an example of a molecule that has polar covalent bonds that are more polar than the bonds in NH3. So I just want to pick a molecule here that's going to have a greater electronegativity difference than nitrogen and hydrogen. So that difference is 0.77. So anything with a bigger difference in electronegativity than that is going to work. So water or carbon tetrafluoride, for example. So a polar bond arises when there is an electronegativity difference between the atoms that's big enough to cause partial charges, but not so large that it produces an ionic bond. So the polarity of the bond is a measure of a physical quantity that we call the dipole moment. So this is represented as a vector. The plus sign is centered on the center of positive charge, and the arrow tip represents the center of negative charge. So here are some dipole moments for a couple different molecules, HF, HCl, and H2O. So how is the center of positive charge on H2O determined? It's right between the positive charge on the two hydrogen atoms. So the center of positive charge is between the two hydrogen atoms. The molecule carbon dioxide is linear and it has polar bonds. So if we think about this, the center of positive charge is going to be on the carbon atom. And the center of negative charge is also on the carbon atom because it's midway between the two oxygen atoms. So for carbon dioxide, this molecule has a dipole moment of zero and it's nonpolar because the center of positive charge and the center of negative charge are in the same place on that carbon dioxide molecule. So here are the experimentally measured dipole moments of several molecules here. So the CO2 and OCS molecules are both linear with polar bonds, but CO2 doesn't have a dipole moment. This is because in OCS, oxygen is more electronegative than sulfur. So the center of negative charge is not going to be centered on that carbon atom. Instead, there will be a little bit of a difference between the center of positive charge and the center of negative charge. So, considering the CCl4 molecule, are the bonds from carbon to chlorine polar? Yes. Those bonds, carbon and chlorine, have a significant electronegativity difference. Where would the center of positive charge be, and where would the center of negative charge be? Those are both going to be centered on the carbon atom. So when the distance between the center of positive charge and negative charge is zero, then the dipole moment will be zero. So it's possible for a molecule to have polar bonds, but for the molecule itself to be nonpolar. This also gets into the shape of the molecule as well, which we'll talk about whenever we do VSEPR. So, considering HF and HCl, which one is bigger? That's going to be chlorine because it has more shells. So, which one will have a longer bond length? That's going to be HCl. And which will have a greater partial positive charge? The F in HF or the Cl in HCl? It's going to be the HF, and that's because the size of this ion impacts how close together those atoms can get. And in the case of HF, F has a higher electronegativity than Cl, so it's going to pull electrons more away from hydrogen and give hydrogen a larger partial positive charge. So why is the dipole moment of HF larger than that of HCl? It's because there's that bigger difference in electronegativity, so that's going to lead to greater magnitudes of partial charge. So in your reflection questions, you can answer number one. That should be pretty straightforward since we just talked about it. But in question two, it says, the difference between ionic and covalent bonding is not distinct, but rather it's a continuum. So whenever we teach types of bonds, we usually teach students, there's an ionic bond, there's a covalent bond. And we kind of teach them like they're separate things, but they're really not. Being ionic or being polar covalent or being nonpolar covalent just depends on the electronegativity difference. So you should think of an ionic bond as the type of situation where the electronegativities are so different that one atom takes an electron from the other. A polar covalent bond is kind of like a weaker version of that. The electronegativity difference is still large enough to produce partial positive and partial negative charges, but not enough to produce a complete partial or complete negative charge. So think of these as a continuum based on the electronegativity difference.